I'd like to call this regular council meeting of November 10th to order. A couple announcements I'd like to make. First is, I had the pleasure of attending the Chamber's Business Excellence Awards on Saturday night. I want to just pass on my congratulations not only to the winners of all the different awards, but all the people that were nominated. It was a great showing and a good evening. Tomorrow, of course, is November the 11th, and I know a lot of the community will be at the Cenotaph tomorrow at 11 o'clock, and we're looking forward to being there and seeing everybody as well. And I just want to remind everybody that November the 17th is going to be a public information session for the proposed rezoning on the highway. It'll be at 7 p.m. at the community center. Looking for a motion to adopt the agenda with any additions, Council Reavers, Council Brothers.
I have some additions.
Yes?
Three additions, actually. I gave notice to everybody that I wanted to bring a motion forward to put off the public hearing and the third reading with respect to the Trans-Canada Highway Bend Road development to January. So I have that, and maybe we can put that after the information is received. And the second thing is, I'd like a discussion with respect to the format of the public information center, or session, I should say. And third thing is, I'd like a discussion with respect to the information that's to be put in the public hearing record with respect to that same building.
Okay, I have to back up a little bit. So you want a new motion for a public hearing date? And what's the next one?
The next one is, I just want a discussion with respect to the format of the public information session. And as well, a discussion with respect to information that's to be put in the public record with respect to this development for the public hearing.
Any more additions to the agenda? We have a mover and a seconder. All those in favor? Motion's carried. Need a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular council meeting of November 27th. Councilor Lando, Councilor English. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. We have two delegations today. Oh, sorry. Is there any business arising from the minutes of that council meeting of October 27th? And moving on to delegations, Mr. Langlois from Revelstoke Accommodation Association. Norm,
thank you.
Would you mind putting up the podium?
Thank you. Great, thank you. I'm going to read my notes if that's all right.
Absolutely.
Mayor McKee and Council, thank you for the opportunity to discuss vacation rentals. I'm here today on behalf of the Revelstoke Accommodation Association and its members. We believe illegal vacation rentals affect every person in our community, if not directly, then indirectly. But first, let me start by saying we are not opposed to vacation rentals. In fact, we applaud those that took the time and financial resources to open them legally. The Revelstoke Accommodation Association represents 21 hotels and 1,150 rooms in Revelstoke. We are very proud of the success of Revelstoke Tourism, to be part of the success of Revelstoke Tourism, providing a variety of accommodations for the various needs of the traveling public. A little over a year ago, members of the community were invited to provide input into the city's vacation rental bylaw. The association attended and provided some recommendations. Earlier this year, we were disappointed to hear council was going to deal with illegal vacation rentals on a complaint basis and not proactively enforce the bylaw. I'd like to think the association is not here to complain, but to provide information not previously known or thought by all councillors at the time of the decision. Our association has three areas of concern over illegal vacation rentals. Number one, a fair playing field. Two, social considerations, including affordable housing and safety. Number three, enforcement penalties and hidden costs to the city. So what do I mean by these three things? First, what we're asking for is a level playing field where everyone plays by the same rules. When you look at the whole picture, hotels and motels have a huge competitive disadvantage when compared to illegal rentals. Hotels charge 8% room tax, 5% GST, 2% marketing, as well as pay commercial property taxes and commercial water and sewer taxes. In addition, hotels carry business licenses, have mandated quantity of parking spaces, and pay separately to have their garbage and recycling removed. The aggregate of which is a considerable amount of cost borne by hotels' guests. Also, by these homes being out of the housing rental market, a shortage is created, pushing up the long-term rental, monthly rentals, for young families and hotel employees. This adds yet another hidden human resource cost to the hotel industry and Revelstoke as a whole. In addition, not enforcing this bylaw is hardly fair to the vacation rentals that have opened legally. Just imagine, if you will, any other industry in town opening up shop and not paying proper taxes or acquiring business licenses. We feel there is an obligation of the city to find the abusers, enforce the bylaw, and ensure all citizens of Revelstoke pay their fair share. Number two, social considerations and affordable housing and safety. In the last few years, a significant number of illegal vacation rentals have opened their doors and are riding the wave of Revelstoke success. Some workers are pushed out of the community to live when they cannot find suitable housing. This all the while housing units sit empty, waiting for high season rentals. We believe many investors would choose not to open vacation rentals if they had the associated costs of a legal rental. This could open more housing desperately needed for young families. They are the future volunteers and coaches. They are the very fabric of our community. In addition, a complaint-generated response may solve noise, complaints, or car congestion issues. However, we'll rarely, if ever, find safety issues such as building code violations, including design of proper handrail steps and smoke detectors, leaving the occupants unaware of these hidden hazards. Number three, enforcement and penalties. Of course, a bylaw without penalties is hardly worth implementing. In this regard, we ask the city to consider that there are financial implications of not going after these offenders. According to a recent raw survey, there are approximately 60 illegal rentals operating with a combined 178 rooms. That is approximately 15% of our hotel room base. If these entities became legal, an additional $12,000 to $20,000 could be generated for city taxes, city licensing fees. If we look at the rentals offering four or more rooms, the potential lost property tax and utility tax revenues could be well over $140,000, quite a significant amount to the local government. These rooms also generate an additional 8% room tax, would also generate an additional 8% room tax for the province, additional revenue for tourism infrastructure, and revenue for tourism marketing. The last two of these coming back to Revelstoke. When you consider nearly half of the legal rentals just opened since 2014, this problem can only get worse as time goes on, and we believe it affects the entire community. Again, we are not opposed to vacation rentals when they play by the rules, and we applaud the few vacation rentals that took the time and financial resources to open legally. Today, the Revelstoke Accommodation Association is asking for a level playing field with vacation rentals, with consideration to required licensing, zoning, safety requirements, and tax contributions. We're not the only community facing the challenge of illegal vacation rentals. However, we may be the first one to get it right. We're asking Council to change their policy to full enforcement of vacation rental laws. Our Hotel Association is open to answer your questions, and we're available for future dialogue. Thank you for your time.
Thanks. Questions from Council? Councilor Nixon?
I believe Mayor Al Rain from Sun Meats was leading the charge on this with the government to try and come up with a cohesive plan the province, but it seems like with the election, it kind of fumbled a bit. So maybe it's time for councillors to work with the Revelstoke Accommodation Association and go to Silka, our local government gathering, and get some support for this, and then take it to the UBCM next year and come up with a, maybe we'll tell them what the plan is. Maybe you're right, maybe we'll get it right.
Councillor Brothers?
It's no secret, I agree with your position, Norm, that it's a real problem throughout. I mean, now we're reading more and more about other municipalities that are going through the same thing and trying to find a way. I mean, Airbnbs are also a big problem, and there's a tremendous amount of Airbnbs here. I think it's as you said, there are three issues as to why we have to look at this, and I would hope that council will take a second look at this. I think there's a way of offsetting the cost of enforcement with all of the benefits of getting the tax revenues and the licensing revenues and everything else, to find a way to deal with this. But I think safety is also a big factor here, and we should take a second look at this.
Councillor Lando.
Thank you, Norm. Have you seen a community that in BC that is on the right track for this?
I personally haven't.
Through my work with the BC DMO Association, so that's the all the city DMOs that are 2% communities, we actually had a meeting that was at the Tourism Industry Conference a few weeks ago, and this was the main topic that we had at our meeting. Probably one of the main communities that's having the biggest issue is Whistler. And do they have a solution at this point in time? No. But they're ardently working on it, and I think it's incumbent upon all of our communities that are resort communities to get together and, first of all, to have the enforcement. Because I think you'll initially have a cost to do the enforcement, but once it's known that anyone opening something up has to be legal, for lack of a better term, then I think you mitigate the cost of doing the policing of it, once the message is out there, that having one just pop up at any time, yes, they will happen, but I think you'll get a far greater degree of compliance than you will just by letting it go. Because letting it go for a free-for-all right now is what's causing the issue in all of these communities. And I was just recently in Ontario with a ski show, and the province of Quebec is actually, through the provincial government, looking at a way to try to enforce this situation. Because it's really killing their B&Bs and things that they would have, say, in places like Quebec City and so on, where they really rely on those small pension style of accommodations. So we are looking at it through the BC DMO Association, absolutely.
Well, I guess a couple of comments I'd like to make, Norm, and that we've going right now on a complaint-only basis, and I think that the main reason for that is that council has been dealing with so many big issues over the last little while, is that we're trying to create a little bit of breathing room. We're back up to a full contingent of staff now, thank you, and we've got a few things behind us. We have a few other ones, but you know, anybody that's ever talked to me or any time that I've been talking about on my radio show is I've always been encouraging people to become a legal vacation rental. At least with a legal vacation rental, you have some certainty over your future. If you are going to continue on an illegal basis, you don't know what's going to happen, and we are not just putting this under the rug and then forgetting about it. It is on the side of the table. It is going to come back. Council is going to be spending some time. I'm hoping that our next strategic planning session, we're going to be sitting down and coming up with a long-term plan. Right now, we're just telling people that we're on a complaint-only basis, but that doesn't mean that it's going to stay like that forever. And I appreciate that people are taking the whole idea of being a good neighbor to heart, because we are getting virtually no complaints about vacation rental, which is what we want. But is it going to stay like this forever? And I, without getting a complete vote and an opinion from council, I would say it's not. Vacation rentals are going to be an issue that's going to be dealt with. It's just right now we're trying to get other things off of our plate. But I think that it's also incumbent on us to sit down with the Hotel Association, listen more in-depth to their concerns and seeing how we can fit in. My biggest concern is the pressure that it puts onto affordable housing. Affordable housing is a big issue, and it's going to become a bigger issue. Vacation rental has a detrimental impact on that, as well as the other items that you brought up. So I don't know what I can tell you right now, but I can tell you that it is not completely off the table. It's not going to stay the way it is forever, and this council is sitting down with staff and are going to have to come up with a long-term sustainable plan on vacation rental.
Yeah, some of these vacation rentals are small three-bedroom ones, and they've got, you know, it's a lot of work to try to get a business license off them. Some of them are five bedrooms, six bedrooms, and they're actually businesses. They're businesses that are operating under the radar. Anything with more than, I think it's four rooms, is not considered to be a vacation rental, but an actual small hotel, a small inn. And there's places out there, and they're, you know, city's not getting its fair share of infrastructure tax back, its fair share of, we're being undercut because they can charge 15% less than us and not pay those taxes, or maybe more than 15% because they're not paying the city taxes that we're paying and those kind of things. I'm not here to complain about those, that's part of life. We all want to do our share and contribute to society. And to me, these folks are operating, and they call it a sharing society sometimes, but they're really, they don't want to contribute to society. They just want to get what they can for themselves, right? I think.
Any more questions or comments from council? Okay, thanks, Norm, for coming.
Thank you very much, Norm.
Thank you. Thank you. Be hearing from us again in the future.
Thank you.
Our second delegation today is Revelstoke Mountain Resort. Peter, you're the man today.
I am indeed. Thank you. Mayor, thank you, first of all, for having me. I apologize if I didn't get able to circulate the information sheet in advance. Just be talking points on the way later, and be happy to take some questions from you. We have four stages. I've got looking back at last year's winter season and then our summer season, what we've got planned for this winter and what things we've accomplished in advance, and really what's new for next summer as well. So we've got some pretty exciting stuff. First of all, I'm really excited that we are seeing some really great snow in the Alpine. So we're off to a really good start, and things are looking really, really good for this coming winter season. I hope some of you have seen some of the footage we've been putting out, and it's getting quite a whistle.
I can't see Norm anymore.
We grew him off yesterday. There's a behind-the-scenes shot of him coming up tomorrow. It's kind of cool. But enough about this season, I'll get to that later. Last year, as you, for those of you who are in this game or were participating in snow sports last year, you know that snow was not at its normal levels. Even in Revelstoke, we had a historically bad winter for snow sport in British Columbia, in really Western North America. However, in Revelstoke, we fared fairly well. We had overall visits were down about 5%, but a lot of that was inside of our season pass base, meaning the local crowd weren't utilizing their season pass as much, and that really drove back to conditions. Some of our other strategies were able to solidify the business, such as our revenues were up marginally. And that was really coming out of a strong start in the early part of the season. We had a really strong early season, so we had a good snow base, made for some historic days over the Christmas period. We had three of our five busiest days over happened last December, which is, so we came out really, really, really strong. And then, as you can recall, we hit a very big wall in snow. However, we've, over the last, over the last 4 years, is to develop the business model to be focused not entirely on a snow-based model. So that means looking outside of our regions and looking towards the destination skier. So destination skier is really what we qualify as anyone who needs to get on a plane or drive more than 8 hours to get to Revelstoke. The reason we really want to have high engagement in that market is, one, we're a conditions-based business. So if you're going to come from a far destination, you need to commit further in advance. So your decision-making isn't based on what snow happened last week. It's you're looking forward months, sometimes years in advance for your trip. The other one is that they tend to stay a lot longer. So what does that mean? That means, you know, we're just dependent on regional market, which we work for very much so for the first 3 or 4 years. You have peak occupancies on Saturday nights and Friday nights. All of the businesses in town thrive on the weekends, and then it gets really quiet during the week because Calgary's gone home. Vancouver's gone home to go back to work. The destination skiers are here typically for 3 to 10 days, and they are, you know, they're interacting with our community, interacting with all of our businesses throughout that time period. And, you know, so that continues to be a really big focus for us. We learned some lessons coming out of this last season around seasonality. I mean, although we didn't suffer nearly as much as some of the other ski resorts in British Columbia, we still saw some, you know, we saw some holes in our game, if you will, and the product we could deliver. So a lot of the stuff, a lot of the initiatives we took over this last summer were, you know, somewhat a direct response to kind of snowproofing our product so that we can offer a really great product no matter what the snow conditions are. So I'll get to that in a second. A lot of the regional traffic that we traditionally was seen coming out of the Calgary market or, Kamloops or Kelowna market coming up to really chase our big snow, we disappeared on us, but we backfilled that with a lot of traffic, some of the shorter decision-making destination traffic out of Washington State, California, further west in Ontario, etc., where particularly in the United States, because the ski conditions were so bad on the coast that we saw people with season passes in Oregon or California just looking to go and actually ski somewhere, or because their hills were either not open or, you know, very much on the best. So the experience that people had here last year was still very positive. People had great ski days. We were skiing top to bottom for most of the season. And, you know, and I really think it's going to have a positive effect on our overall reputation moving forward. And people saw what it could be in the big snow year. So. Moving on to summer. So we continued with our summer operation this year. So our sightseeing and breakfast program are really operational. We saw an increase of about 4%. We expanded our summer services we kept our retail store open, while Baguette stayed open, and we had spa open all summer. Hotel traffic was significantly up again. Moving forward for coming summers, we've got some other initiatives that are really going to hopefully drive those numbers significantly. We see a lot of opportunity, and that persists a lot of opportunity in summer. I'll talk a little bit about that for new for summer 16 and what our long-term plans are for summer. We really think that that's where the real opportunity for growth is at this point. New for winter. So coming out of this last winter, some of the initiatives, one of the bigger initiatives we've undertaken is the opening of 11-acre train park. So it's going to have over 20 jump features and a range of jumps. It's going to be located not quite directly under the stoke chair on a wide SWF run, if you're familiar with that area. A perfect little bench for riding the climb. It's something our clientele has been begging us for a long time. It's really an initiative to, you know, enhance people's experience, particularly when we are in drought periods of snow. So trying to shift Revelstoke from just being it's only good if it's powdered, but it's good all the time. So that's one of the big projects, a pretty major project. And we're hoping to have it open for opening day. So conditions are getting to the point where we're going to start building. All of our kind of solid features are already all built, but we do need to get the jumps and stuff going. We did another extensive glading projects this year. So we gladed 50 plus acres through glide seed prayer off the stoke chair, snorkel, beauty glades, and the river chair area. Really focused on connectivity. So trying to create more connectivity within our related teams so that it enhances experience, and it's not a lot easier for someone new to Revelstoke to experience the expanded levy. And we really highlighted it in our marketing materials and in our trail map materials where these new levy areas are, so that it's not a secret. Some of you might be disappointed that it was not a secret, but we're really trying to enhance that experience for that destination skier. Another thing we really identified as being something we really need to do is around grooming. So we did two initiatives around grooming. One was we added a snowcat. Added a completely new snowcat to the fleet. And then the other was to do some pretty extensive brushing and earthwork projects, really focusing on our signature groom runs. Did a lot of earthing, so the way take a run, and it might be, have logs lying on it, stumps, and when it's covered in snow, it's great, and you don't even know what's there, but from when it comes to lower snow seasons, or later in the season, or earlier in the season, it can be very challenging to groom those areas, or there's areas where there's holes, etc. So we put about 90 days of machine time onto the signature runs, so that we've got a lot of it just perfectly flat and it's pretty much grass, so that we can groom that right to the end and really, really early, and effectively added another cap to our fleet with these projects, because of all the time that we get spent trying to fix a hole or trying to push snow over top of stumps, etc., to try and keep things skiable. So we really feel we've effectively expanded our fleet by two for this kind of season. So again, that's part of the vision to really focus on having a product that's not dependent on strictly powder skiing. So looking forward to this this upcoming season, we're still fairly early in the booking window for a lot of transient. Transient markets, but our group and our FIT, which is our really destination companies, destination travelers coming out of other countries, were very, very strong for this kind of season. We did a lot of sales activity over the towards the end of the last season and through the summer, really promoting what the ski product was like here last season comparatively, because there was a lot of negativity in the marketplace around British Columbia, Western North America. Conditions last year, and it appears that we've been successful. So we're really looking at somewhere between 20-25% increases from last year in these markets. So I mean, I know you're not going to translate any 25% more visitors this year, but it's again a key market or that transit, the long haul destination traveler who want to continue to build. So we're pretty excited about this season. Summer. New for summer 2016. Again, as I stated earlier, we really feel that the summer is a really big opportunity for Revelstoke. And summer is a busy period in Revelstoke as it is. However, our traffic our average length of stay for our overnight visitor can probably be measured in hours versus days. We're very much dependent on that being in a quarter in between great destinations, and we're a stop. We hope to change that. So we're really making some big investment into our summer program, hoping to anchor that, be the anchor for expanding throughout the community of activities. But really, we need to have people staying extra time for all of the other businesses to take off. So the entrepreneurial fly fishing companies, that sort of thing, need a market that is here long enough to consume the products. So if we can take that average of the stay into days, it'll have a really big material impact on all businesses as well. So we'll see, instead of having one meal in Revelstoke, we have four or five or six. And shopping in the downtown core and consuming all of the other things we have to offer. The first real big project, you probably have already heard of it, and it was presented at Council not too long ago, our new mountain coaster. It was completely installed as of Thursday last week, so we had a conditional safety from BC Safety Authority conditionally give us approval. And so it's been functioning, we've done some test rides on it, and it's a really cool feature. It's a 1.4 kilometer long track, basically from Mid-Mountain, that delivers you down to the base of the mountain. At max speeds of 42 kilometers an hour. It's the first in North America, but a very popular destination amusement in Europe and Asia. So we're really really excited about being able to offer that starting mid-May next year. And I was hopeful that we would be doing a local CP comment on it this week, but we kind of, with the snow creeping down at us, we kind of panicked and decided that we may have to pull it out of the ground. And so it actually has to be disassembled because it runs across our runs. So that's the peak's going to be in spring. So, we'll see lots of things anticipation building for that. So we will be also expanding our summer operations to Upper Gondola, operations for our sightseeing program. With plans to expand that into an expanded hiking program at the top of Gondola, and that would be a lot of fun. And eventually incorporating that hiking into that program as well, likely the following year. That kind of kicks down my whole presentation. Any of you can ask for questions? Or?
And you got your work towards the November 28th opening?
Thank you. That's kind of key. Yes, November 28th will be opening day. As I said earlier, conditions on the mountain are outstanding. We could literally open to the bottom of the slope. Yeah.
Thanks.
It's really nice up there.
Councilor Nixon, Councilor Brothers.
I'd just like you to thank you for being here today and being the anchor that pulls the people through this town, like the resort does that. So thanks for working on the future and all the work that you're doing for the summer travel as well.
Thank you.
Just a question, Peter, about the coaster. How many people can you get on it? Is it one ride per time, or do you get three people on or two people on?
So it's gondola based. So you ride a gondola up,
yep.
And then as you come off the gondola, right as you come off the gondola, the track actually starts immediately to your right. So there's a bank that goes down towards the road, and then there's a tunnel that goes under the road. It's a single track, and so there's a little carpet clicks onto it, and you go in intervals. So you can have multiple riders on the track at once, but there's a minimum interval in between. And you're actually self-controlled, so you have control for your own to stop, and control your speed as well.
Councilor Rondo.
Your Worship, Peter, in terms of partnerships for your summertime operations and turning that into sort of an anchor, offering what sort of ways can the city partner with RMR to help that along?
Well, I think the biggest part is an open dialogue. We're likely to come at you with some ideas and different proposals, and really just being open to them and providing feedback and dialogue. Some of the things we want to do are going to be inside city limits, and some of them will be up in the outcome, but. And then support and promoting. And I think the biggest, our biggest proponents for all of our products are the citizens of Revelstoke. So being ambassadors for the public is key for us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And everybody's excited with the snow coming down and looking forward to a great year. So
great, me too. I haven't been skiing yet.
Any other questions or comments from council? Peter, thanks for coming. We will have you guys back on a regular basis to keep us updated and keep the community updated on what's going on. Looking forward to it. Thank you. We have no old business. We're moving to new business. Councilor English?
Yes, I'm going to recuse myself. Thank you. It's been suggested that there's a conflict due to my employment. There's only a law on 28. I'm going to recuse myself.
Thank you.
9A, I move that the table prepared by staff in response to council's questions and inquiries related to zoning bylaw text amendment application number, sorry, I'm having some issues with my iPad, I think this should say 2088, if I'm correct, 2015-04 be received.
Motion by Councilor Lemon, seconded by Councilor Salz. Discussion on the motion? Do you want to discuss it?
Just as just general background, as everyone in council I'm sure is aware, staff has prepared a report with answers from questions from council. Item does note that there's a presentation, and I'm wondering if that's forthcoming from staff.
Yes.
Well, on that point, I'm going to have a lot of questions for Mr. Strachan as a result, but I just want to make some submissions or comments with respect to that. I don't think I have the time or the energy to do it today, but I'm wondering whether or not it's available to do at the next council meeting. That's what I'm going to
do. I have no idea. It's your call.
Well, I don't want to ask the questions now because I haven't had time to review all of the questions, to think about all of the questions and to deal with them, but there's 11 pages of questions there that I just looked at on Sunday. And right off the bat, I have a number of questions, but I'd like to spend some time and energy dealing with Mr. Strachan on that, and so I'm wondering whether or not we can deal with that at the next council meeting, and I can ask my questions and deal with it then.
I think that you can ask. Sorry? Mr. Strachan.
Your Worship, the motion is to receive the table. Yeah. Additional questions can follow afterwards.
That's what I was going to say. You can ask questions to staff anytime you want. Did you want to add anything to that? Councilor Lando.
Yeah, I'm just generally making the same comment. This is, as Councilor Brothers knows, a really long report with lots of information contained in it, but at this point the motion is to
receive
this report for information, and I understand that the Councilor Brothers also wants to discuss this as a further item, is that
correct? Well, they have other things after this.
Yes. Yeah, so of course there's many topics of information, but right now we're just looking to receive this report.
Right. And so I'm only one deal with the motion that's on the floor. And is there any more comments or questions about the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Now, Councillor, you asked to put a new motion on the floor.
Yes, I'd like to bring a new motion on the floor to defer the public hearing and the third reading, which is now scheduled for November 24th, to sometime in January, no later than the end of January, and so that would be my motion.
Putting a motion to defer the public hearing date till sometime in January. That's your motion.
Yes.
Is there a seconder for that motion?
I'll second that motion for discussion only.
Motion seconded by Councillor Salz. The floor is open. You made the motion?
I made the motion. So it's no secret that this is one of the most crucial decisions that Revelstoke Council has to make since the Revelstoke Mountain Resort, and as with the resort, it has significant potential impacts to the community. I was a little bit surprised with the setting of the timing. I didn't hear about the timing until I got the notice that went out to the public, and I thought this was going to come back to council today to deal with the timing and how we move forward on this. One of the things I have concerns about is having all of the information in front of not only for the open house or the public hearing, but also for the third reading. We're having the open house next week. The developer, and I'd like to discuss what the process is going to be there, but the developer is going to give some information. We have, I think what we need to do is to refer all of the information that comes before council and then comes to not only the APC but also the Economic Development Committee and the Chamber of Commerce. We have these committees for a reason. My understanding is, and when I did my questions, I specifically said, I would like all of these to be referred, all of the answers and all of the questions to be referred to the APC, the EDC, and the Chamber of Commerce so they can weigh in on this. I think we need as much information and enough, as much input as possible. As well, for my part, since the last council meeting, there's been an enormous amount of information coming forward. There's 400 or 500 pages that are attached to this particular submission. I've plowed through it as best I can. It's been very difficult. It takes a lot of time and energy. I don't know whether other people have had the same problem. But that doesn't even include the OPC, and all of a sudden there's some issues with respect to the OPC based on the questions and answers that Mr. Stratton has given. There's another 75 pages that I have to read. So from my own personal view as well, I need some time to look at this, to consider this, and to do a good job. There's 11 pages of questions that were put to Mr. Stratton. There's 11 pages of answers. I want to take a look at that. I want to consider those. I want to deal with them in 2 weeks' time when we come back to council next to ask some further questions as a result of that, because there's a multitude of questions that arise as a result of Mr. Stratton's answers. So all of these, my understanding is the APC and the EDC do not meet until December. That's after the proposed public hearing, which is on November 24th. So we can't have any input from the APC and the EDC if we have a public hearing in November. So I need some time to digest and think about all this. It's a really important decision. If this were a slam dunk, it'd be no problem. We could move as quickly as we're moving now, but it's not. There are some serious issues that have been raised that need to be thought about and need to be reviewed by council. I want to make sure we do it right. The OPC and the OCP and the retail strategy report indicate that there are some concerns that we have to address. I've read these reports, but I think they have to come further to council for further discussion. They also have to come to those committees for further discussion. So here's what I'm proposing, is that at the next council meeting, we get a chance to ask further questions of Mr. Strachan, and all of the information will then be referred, not only from the public meeting with the developer, but also all of this information that comes from further information from Mr. Strachan, all be referred to the EDC, the AP, the Advisory Planning Committee, and the Chamber. They have a chance to weigh in on it, that we have a public hearing sometime in January, and that we have the vote 1 week after. That gives everybody the time to digest all of this information, to get all of the information in front of the public hearing. I don't see any downsides to delaying this for a couple of months. December is a throwaway month. There's nobody who's going to want to do anything in December. It's just a Christmas month, and we're not going to get anybody to contribute, or a public hearing will be useless in December. So I'm just suggesting we put it over to January. As I said, I don't see any downsides to delaying this for a further 2 months, and I think only upsides to make sure that we do a really good job on this. This is really important. We really have to do a good job on this and have all of the information so we as a council can make the right decision.
Phew, that was Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, are we not getting the report delivered to Council from Mr. Mason on Friday of this week?
I believe so, yes.
And that would represent the Economic Development Commission that he works closely with. And everybody can come to the public hearing and give us their input.
Yes, they can. I guess I'd just like to remind Councilor Brothers that if you have questions for staff, you don't have to wait to come to a council meeting to submit those questions. They can be sent in to whoever is appropriate to answer it, and council would be getting that information, and it would become part of the public record as well.
And I understand that.
Okay.
And it's been done, and we have done it by written interrogatories, if you want to call it that. But there's something that's a little bit better when you can be face-to-face with somebody and you can ask the questions, and if something comes up, then you can follow through with that particular question. So I just think it's a better process. We've been through the interrogatory process, and we should do it face-to-face.
Yes, I have a presentation from Mr. Strack, and it's my suggestion, and I'll ask those questions.
Right now.
He's here, he works for us, and he's ready to answer questions anytime I want to.
Well, we do have it slated down for a presentation.
Here to answer council's questions.
Council Rhodes?
And I have to say, I mean, I don't understand the rush in this. As I said, I've been reading like 900 pages of documents, trying to get through all of this. And we're, you know, we're rushing in 2 weeks to make a decision on something that's crucial to this community. I don't get it. I don't understand why we're rushing. I don't understand what 2 months is going to make, how 2 months is going to make a difference.
Council Orlando?
Your worship, I'm not going to support this motion. And my main reason is what's before us is driven by the developer. They have options as to how they can bring forward this zoning bylaw text amendment. They have lots of options in terms of how they can do their public outreach, how they can approach the city, the council, the community to do this. The question we're going to be deciding upon after the public hearing and receiving information is largely based on what they are bringing forward. It's not a city-driven process. When I was first elected to council, I went to see Mr. Chabot's predecessor, and I had really one concern I wanted to address regarding management, not government, but management, and that was that we had a lot of trouble with our, in my opinion, after sitting over at that table for 6 years in our public consultation and outreach. And I felt that the city should, as a whole, be shored up and get on some sort of a consistent program to make sure we're consistent and we were following a step-by-step process that the community can understand. And I don't think we're there yet, so I realize there's issues, but ongoing. But at this point, we've been through already a bit of a convoluted process. We've identified something, including a new public information session, a new hearing, and I think that's adequate enough. Essentially, the developer's coming to us and asking us, we want this, and we need to make a decision based on the planning processes that we've already done and we have in place in the past. So I'm ready to do that. If this were some sort of a city initiative or a city process that we were engaging in, for sure, I say, what's the rush? For sure, let's move it forward. But this is a question that's being brought to us, and I think it's our job to be prepared to make a decision. I don't think it's ideal. I don't think we've had an ideal process. I think most of council would agree with me, but this is where we're at, and we have enough opportunity to receive public input at this point, and that's my point.
Other questions from council? Councilor Solis.
Councilor Brothers, your worship, just one comment. Councilor Brothers and I have discussed this previous to this, and I had a chance to give some thought to your concern and to your motion going forward, and wanted to discuss this in council as you did. And after giving some thought and I have business partners who in the past have been developers, and I understand the process that we're going through, and then from a developer's perspective, I understand how they feel. If they need to get on with things, whether it's a two-month delay or not, a two-month delay could mean that the developer isn't able to get his housing order, to get his plans, that sort of thing. Even though we look at it and say, well, what's the problem? You can't, in my comment was, you can't put the shovel into the ground probably during the winter anyway. And I'm going to go back on that comment, and after giving some thought, and what I've seen my business partners do in the past was they would walk away. And I'm concerned that that may be the case in this situation. So I will not support the deferment at this time.
Is there any more discussion on the motion? The motion is to defer the public hearing till sometime in January. All those in favor?
Aye.
was way for you to put your hand up. All those against? Motion is denied. Motion fails. Councilor Brothers, you asked to have discussion of the format of the public information meeting.
Right, and the only thing is, I've read again, the only reason I know how the public format is proposed is because I read it in Mr. Stratton's report. I didn't get any input before that, but as I understand it, the public process will be such that Mr. Stratton will be...
Karen, I just want to ask a question on your behalf.
Okay. Mr. Stratton will give a presentation, and then there will be a couple of people of the developers that will be in the room to answer questions one-on-one. I think that's going to be an unwieldy process. I think there are going to be a lot of people there. I think we already had an experience with McPherson and how that went, and people were really upset that they didn't get a chance to ask questions of the developer in public. We already did that process with Citrus Capital, and that was a really good process. He got up in the middle of the room, and people came to the podium and asked their questions, and he responded. Everybody got to hear what the responses were. I think there are a lot of questions to be put to the developer. And so, you know, the one-on-one, I think, is going to be a really a difficult process for the community, and I don't think it will be satisfactory.
I guess, Councillor, the first thing that I think about is that the process where we're in right now, where we've had all these questions and a lot of information, and it's coming back from Mr. Strachan. I'm expecting, and I've been wrong before, is that a lot of this back and forth that we're doing right now is going to be answering a lot of people's questions. Going to the public information and having the boards drawn up and having the whole Pacific people there, staff is going to be there, and I'm not sure who's from council is going to be there, but I plan on attending and observing, and if people want to ask me questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I just think that at the point we're in now, there is so much information going back, so many opportunities for people to contact council, which those emails or contact information is being circulated and is becoming part of the public process. I just think that we're turning this rezoning is turning into information overload. And I guess what I'm looking forward to is what are the things that haven't been talked about or haven't been thought of. That's the opportunity for it at the public information. There's an opportunity for it at the public hearing, and council's gonna have to make a decision based on listening to that information. So I don't know if Mr. Strachan has any other comments on the process and the format of how it was chosen or not chosen.
Thank you, Your Worship. The format is a open house format, so there's going to be a brief presentation from myself beginning of the public information meeting to outline the project itself, what's been proposed, what the process is, more just the nuts and bolts of what's happening so people have an understanding. When people arrive, they'll be signing in at a sign-in table and we'll be given a comment sheet. They'll have the opportunity to fill out whatever information they wish on that comment sheet and submit them as they leave or immediately after they arrive. It's up to them. We'll continue to accept them for the next few days up until the public hearing, and we even accept those comment sheets the day of the public hearing. Council's going to receive all of those comment sheets as a package, as well as a summary from myself about the public information session, how many people attended, what the duration was, all the details of it, at the November 24th regular council meeting. That it becomes part of the information for the public hearing. So all those comment sheets, and the reason we select that type of process versus the process you're speaking to, the town hall process, is it allows more voices to be heard. There's not very many people, there are quite a few people, there are not very many people who are comfortable to stand up in a crowd, especially because we are anticipating a large number of people, and speak their peace of mind to a full audience. There's not very many people that can do that comfortably. And you know what, when you stand up to that mic, I don't know how many times you've ever done it, but you forget, and there's pieces that you missed, and there's pieces that you meant to say that you didn't. Whereas if you can sit down and write it, we're going to get more detailed information. We're also going to get the information in their own words. We're not relying on staff to interpret or take minutes or try to record what that person meant. It's in their own words, and it's clear to council.
So just to kind of play in the middle of this thing here, is there an opportunity either there or later on where people are submitting written questions and we could be answering them right there or answer them and make it part of the package for the public hearing?
We are open to answering any questions at the meeting. We encourage people to ask us if they have a question.
I'm talking about take the question, read it out to the people that are there, and give the answer to them. And I think that's kind of the point that you're getting at. And you know,
what unfortunately that does, you end up with a town hall meeting format where I would then be in the center of a series of questions from people, and I wouldn't get the opportunity to ask to speak to people individually one on one. Even with this number of people, it's one on one conversations take between 3 and 5 minutes. We get through a lot of people in a very short period of time in that format. Whereas if we're going public hearing or public town hall meeting format, you have 10, 15 minutes, especially if you get someone who loves that mic. You could be stuck there for half an hour on that one individual. People at the end of the night will not have the opportunity to ask the question.
Okay. I'm going to go around the table because there are a few other people, and then I'll come back to you.
Your Worship, the format that Mr. Strachan is proposing on using, you were away when we did the one for Mr. Evans' project up on Nickel Road, and there were people that were complaining about it, but it was the people that usually like to talk. And there were a lot of quiet people that really, really appreciated the process that we used. And I think, do we not get 150 almost of people that followed the process and felt their voices being heard?
Any hands up over this side?
Well, the only other point I would say is that, you know, when you have a one-on-one, the same question may be asked 15 times. When somebody comes up to the mic, they answer it, and everybody gets the same answer. I just think it's a better process for the public. I think they feel better afterwards. They can still write comments. I mean, if they have further comments, they can write comments. The silent ones can write the comments, but at least we then get an open question and answer period. And I don't think it should be Mr. Strachan who answers questions that are put to the developer. It should be the developer who answers the questions.
Well, I guess it depends on the question. If it's a rezoning and it's a process and it's something to do with the city, this is...
Yep.
So it depends on the question. Councilor Lennon.
I think maybe there's some opportunity for a middle ground here. I do understand what Councillor Brothers is saying, and that people can walk away pretty soon if they feel they were there to ask a question. But I do agree with what Dean says, is usually what you get is not questions, but declarations, and people have the opportunity to make those at the public hearing after that. If we could, I would support just asking staff to manage it in a way where, you know, we get a 25-minute time frame and we let everyone know who has a strong opinion that the place for that opinion is to come out to the public hearing and make sure council and staff, make sure council hears that clearly there. I would be happy with something like that. But, I mean, you know, Mr. Strachan's right. Oftentimes the mic can be dominated by people who don't have questions or just want to provide a declaration, and it is an information hearing, and we do have an opportunity. That's my suggestion.
Okay. I was actually just trying to save a few questions that are going to get phoned into me on the radio on Friday morning. So I'll deal with that, and it makes my job a little bit easier. That's okay. This was just a discussion. There was no motion on the floor. And you also asked for a discussion. Public.
The information, the only thing I would ask is when it's said and the public information goes into for the public hearing, can we be advised as a council beforehand so that if we think that there's something missing or whatever, at least we can make a comment?
Mr. Strachan.
Your Worship, there will be a summary report of the public information meeting that will include all the comment sheets that will be part of the council agenda. It will be available to you normally on Thursday by noon or so. That information will be available, so from Tuesday until Thursday, we will be getting that all together at the council's review. And it will be on your council agenda for November 24th.
Which also means that the public will be able to go to that agenda, look at it, and read those comments prior to...
That's correct.
Yes.
Your worship, there is also a link on our website that contains all the information and all the comments that have been collected to date. And there's a binder available at City Hall, which also contains all the information and comments that are...
Council Brothers.
Sorry, the feedback that I've received about the link is that some people just can't, nothing comes up, because I guess it's so big that it doesn't come up. So people have said, listen, I tried to get on the link 15 times, but it's not coming. So I'm wondering whether or not we can separate it out into...
So that
then people can access it, because I know I had several people that were complaining to me saying I can't get on.
Sure, because it is in the binder divided up between reports, maps, comments, and it's also a collection of everything from the very first bylaw reading. Right, so we recently did a couple times. There's a lot of information in there, but yeah, we probably break it out into two of those comments.
Okay. Any more discussion on the discussion? Okay, there's no motion, so I think our counselor can come back.
Thank you.
So we were at item 9B. If somebody would like to do that.
Yes, your worship, I'll bring forward the heritage alteration permit number HAP 2015-06. Be approved.
Motion by...
I'm
going to
recuse myself on this,
so it's
listed by
the teacher. Okay.
Very little late in the...
Councilor Brothers, recuse yourself.
Yes.
We have... We have a motion by Councilor Nixon, seconded by Councilor English. And Mr. Strachan, you have a presentation for us.
Very briefly, Your Worship.
Thank you.
As noted, it is a heritage alteration permit for 400 Mackenzie Avenue. Potential purchaser for the property is interested in converting the single-family dwelling into a boutique-type hotel, similar to a bed and breakfast, but due to its zoning, it reclassified as a hotel accommodation. As a part of their changeover, they are required to add additional parking stalls. The parking modification to the lands, as it is within the heritage area, requires a heritage alteration permit. This has been reviewed with the Heritage Advisory Commission, and they provided a supporting resolution. Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you, Mr. Strachan. Parking, I see he's got bus parking over in the corner. That's pretty darn nice. Questions from council, Councilor Nixon.
Just talked to Mr. Strachan earlier about this today. Just want to ensure that this is one of our alleyways that is currently being plowed for snowing.
Your Worship, yeah, we confer that it is.
Okay. Other questions? Councilor Orlando.
Not so much a question, but a statement. This is the McCarty House, I believe, named after Mayor McCarty, from who took office in 1899. Great mustache. Second most handsome mayor on the wall. There's the looking guy in the color section. He actually made his money, I understand, by running boarding houses on CPR Hill, and for our seasonal traffic, which we have a lot of, and seem to have had a lot of for 115 years, and it's interesting to see that this is proposed for a conversion, and that our business models in the community remain the same, but evolve somewhat, so very interesting.
Plus c'est change, plus c'est le même chose. Any more questions for Mr. Strachan or on this motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Mr. Strachan, would you mind letting the counselor in? She's,
Good
We are on item 9C. Who would like to do this?
I'll do this, Your Worship. That council approves development variance permit application number DVP 2015-15 and give notice of their intention to consider the issue of a development variance permit number DVP 2015-15 for strata lots 11 to 20, EPS 452, 101B to 110B, 1240 Powerhouse Road, and zoning bylaw number 2064, section 11A 16-.29 is varied to allow for an increase in the maximum size of recreation commercial accommodation units from 70 square meters to 76 square meters.
Motion by Councilor Nixon, seconded by Councilor English. Mr. Strachan, you have a presentation for us?
Very, very briefly, Your Worship. This is a property on Powerhouse Road where we rezoned it earlier this year. It was adopted to rezone it to a new CD zone. As the developer began to sell the units off, the purchasers began designing these second floor units in the building and identified that the areas were a little bit small for what their needs were by the time they put in staircases and mechanical rooms. The 70 square meters was based on an existing unit that's in the first building. It was used as a template. So now the owners are back requesting a variance to increase that to 76 square meters.
That's really what this is all about, going from 70 meters to 76.
Yes, Your Worship.
Discussion on the motion. Is that everything, Mr. Strachan? Sorry?
That's it, Your Worship.
Thank you. Discussion on the motion, Councilor Sells.
I have my understanding, Your Worship, that this is going to be, this variance will be inside the building. You won't see anything from the outside. So I think, from my perspective, shouldn't change anything, and I would support this.
I think it's pretty minor. Any more discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Strachan. Item number D.
Yes, Your Worship, I'll bring forward that the zoning bylaw text amendment application to add vacation rental use subzone to the RR2 rural residential 2-hectare district be approved to proceed, and that the rezoning of lot 9, plan 636K402 Cedar Street from RR2 rural residential 2-hectare district to RR2B rural residential 2-hectare vacation rental district be approved to proceed.
Thank you, Councilor Nixon. Motion seconded by Councilor Sells. And Mr. Strachan, you have a presentation as well.
Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you.
The subject property is zoned a zoning district RR2 rural residential 2-hectare. This zone does not have a vacation rental subzone within it. So the applicant has applied to add this subzone to the zoning bylaw, as well as to rezone their particular property to that V subzone to allow for an existing vacation rental to be sanctioned by council.
Thank you. Discussion from questions from council. Councilor Orlando.
Your Worship, when I was reading this, I just a little bit confused. So we're looking to add vacation rental to RR2, and vacation rental is not allowed in RR2 currently?
Your Worship, the subzone for vacation rental use is not a permitted use within that zoning district at this point in time. So it's being proposed to be added as a subzone. So it's not being afforded automatically to every property that has this zoning. You still have to go through the zoning process to get that subzone. But we only included a select group of zones. Originally it was the R1, R1A, R2, R2A that we proposed the subzone to. Since that time we've added it to the RR04 and the R4 zoning district in single family only. This proposal would be to add it to the RR2 rural residential district. as a subzone. So if it, that component is approved, that subzone would be available for application, but it does not grant it to the particular property. That's why we need the second part, the second resolution, which is to actually rezone the subject property to that subzone.
Which is the R2B.
Correct.
Okay. Just creating as much opportunity for anybody that wants to make a vacation rental legal. This is what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Councilor Lando.
Your Worship, what does that do in terms of creating a precedent? I realize we had a similar application in a different zone in Lower Town. What's going to be the impact on applications coming forth for all our RO2 properties?
To be turned into vacation rental?
Yeah.
Everyone would have to go through this process of rezoning, and it would come to this table, and the neighbors would be notified, and they would have the opportunity, just like any rezoning, to come and make a submission or presentation to council, and council has the ultimate authority to make that decision, yes or no. And it gets down to that whole issue that I keep bringing up as being a good neighbor. Mr. Strachan?
Your Worship, and you noted this, council has an unfettered ability. There is no precedent setting on any rezoning. So one of the reasons the tool was selected for vacation rentals is even if council's approved five, there is no precedent setting that they are going to have to approve the six. Each one has to stand on its own merits, and the council has the full ability to deny any which one at any point.
Any more comments or questions? Motion on the floor to approve. All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Strachan. Item number E.
Yes, Your Worship, I'll bring forward that the development variance permit number DVP 2015-12 be approved.
Motion by Councillor Nixon, seconded by Councillor English. Mr. Strachan, haven't we had a presentation on this in the past?
We have, Your Worship. So we introduced this particular application at the last council meeting. Now it is coming forward to council for approval. So similar to the one that we saw earlier with Powerhouse Road, that one now has letters going out to the neighbors. So tomorrow the neighbors receive the letter. That will return on November 24th for council to consider issuance. This one at the previous council meeting, we got approval to send the letters out to the neighbors. We've now had input back and are reporting back to council for issuance of the permit. So this particular application, as was noted in the previous council meeting, includes replacing an existing porch with a new porch, which is going to be slightly wider than the original porch on the home, requiring the variance to from council. Thank you, Your Worship.
Questions from council? Comments? Motion on the floor to approve. All those in favor? Motion carried. Thank you, Mr. Strachan. Where are we? Item F.
After that, recommendation that that the Revelstoke Business Retention and Expansion Report dated fall 2015 be received as information.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor Sells. Discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Item G. Intersection design RFP.
I'll bring that forward, Your Worship. I move that the city enter into a contract with McCallany Consulting Services Limited to provide engineering services for the Victoria intersection at the Victoria Fourth Townley intersection in accordance with the scope outlined in the RFP documents with McCallany proposal.
Motion by Councillor Saul, seconded by Councillor English. Discussion on the motion. Everybody's gone through this. I think it's a fairly serious situation that we should be dealing with as quickly as possible. No comments? All those in favor? Motion's carried. See how serious and people just want to deal with it right now. That's good. Engineering, item H.
I'll bring that forward as well, Your Worship. I move that the staff be directed to proceed with the replacement of the Greeley transmission water main using the open cut existing alignment option with funds allocated, reallocated from the Illecillewaet River Crossing Project to address the emergent Alpine Way water main issues, and that staff be authorized to direct award contracted services and materials procurement for the project.
Motion by Councilor Saul, seconded by Councilor English. Mr. Thomas, you have a presentation for us.
Your Worship, just a short presentation, some photos of what we're looking at here, but just for everyone's benefit, we've got two 300 millimeter diameter asbestos cement water mains in this area that are installed around 1970. And a couple of weeks ago, we discovered chlorinated water that was seeping from the highway, seeping from the rock and earth embankment above the highway. And these two locations, about 20 meters apart, with a rock about the size of this room in between them. The water main is somewhere behind that rock, and we believe it's around 5 to 6 meters deep in that location, because it looks like in the past, in that area, that after the pipes were installed, the land was made flatter by either by the city or by someone up there. What that has done, it's made it very difficult to reach the pipe. We actually attempted, but we abandoned the attempt. It was too difficult, too dangerous to proceed with the equipment that we've got without doing some serious engineering for worker safety. As a result, we're unable to determine which pipe is leaking or if both are leaking. This is compounded by the fact that we don't have valves on these lines, so we can't actually shut off one whole line and just run the other one and see if that one stops leaking or not. It's impossible to do this sort of test. So that's the situation that we've got. That's a photo of from above looking down on the guys working. You can see down on the highway below, that's the Bacta truck cleaning up the ditch down the bottom. We had the water running out of the embankment onto the highway. We've now we've widened out Highway's ditch there to contain this water as best we can. For reference, the water line basically runs along below where the photo's taken from, sort of along the right-of-way there. And we could only get in a mini excavator like that, but to the depth that we were digging, it was getting dangerous to go any further. This is a shot from below on that right-of-way looking up to where we were excavating. And again, this is a shot from the highway looking up, and you can see the excavators up there, and there's a house up above that. It's a very difficult site to work on. So basically where that is looking, if you look at the pipe in profile and the height looking, say, looking from the highway up the embankment, the pipe is, you know, some 5 meters deep in this location, so we think the leak is somewhere around here. So what do we do about that? So just for reference, this is about 120 meter long section that we're looking at, with a very deep section in between. But we need to isolate the pipe at various or locations that make sense. So some of the risks: it's extremely challenging to actually repair the pipe if we could reach it. The total water loss is unknown. It's fairly porous material up there. We know that some of it's reaching the highway, but some of it might just be going straight down. That whole hillside is generally very wet. So if there were a pipe failure, it could impact the embankment above the Trans-Canada Highway, which may impact traffic and private property. And in the past, I understand there have been some serious issues on that hillside related to water breaks or to water flow. It's a very sandy hillside, so if you have a large volume of water flowing, it will erode very quickly. In terms of the probability of that happening, it's really unknown, but the risks may be increased due to the poor construction that we've seen on pipe in nearby areas. So looking back here, this pipeline obviously extends all the way up to Greeley in this direction. About 100 meters back east of this location, we uncovered the pipe for another leak that we had probably a month and a half ago. And at that leak, there were just the construction practices. These pipes should be bedded in proper construction bedding sand. There were just rocks around the pipe. It wasn't constructed in a way that it would be constructed today. So it's made of asbestos cement pipe, which can be quite brittle if it's under certain loads. We don't know if this hillside's moving in that location. Doesn't obviously look like it is, but that may have caused the breaks. The pipes are generally, asbestos cement pipes are generally reaching the end of their life, sort of, I guess, in this, depending on how they're installed, they could have a lifespan of 50 years to 80 years, but many asbestos cement pipes are already failing. It's just the materials that they use. So what are we proposing is basically the red line there represents a single pipe, a single larger diameter pipe that would replace the two 300 millimeter pipes installed at a shallower depth through that deep section, but in a deeper through where it's shallow, because the pipe is literally about 6 inches below the ground in some locations. So we want to get it down to a depth that protects it from frost in those heavy frosts. So one of the challenges is transitioning it back to the existing 300 millimeter pipes on each end. So we would have to create these couplings, I guess, at each end of it. So you're going from a large diameter pipe, some bands, back to the 300 millimeter pipe at the other end, and some reducers on this one. So you'd be doing that at both ends of the pipe. So some of the benefits, the existing two 300 millimeter pipes actually have less capacity than one 450 millimeter pipe. And over time, we would be suggesting that requires upgrading to a 450 millimeter pipe in the future. In terms of longevity, the AC pipe is likely reaching its lifespan, and a PVC pipe would likely last 80 or more years if installed correctly. And from a safety perspective, the existing pipes are difficult to access, and we would like to be able to repair pipes if they do have issues. This one we're unable to repair, and so we're suggesting replacement. In terms of the costs that are outlined in the report and the duration of the project, the new alignment option appears a little bit cheaper there and a little bit shorter in duration, but it may have its own set of problems that's not really detailed in the report. I'm concerned about getting closer to the edge of the embankment there. I'd rather be either on the existing alignment or even uphill of it if possible. The surprise for staff was this in-situ pipe rehabilitation. Often we hear that we should be using trenchless technologies and rehabilitating the infrastructure that we have. And in an ideal world, we would be doing that. We'd be using the materials that we've got in the ground and just this in-situ pipe liners. It's literally just a big plastic bag that goes inside the pipe, and they expand it out and it cures on the inside of the pipe, and it gives you a new structural lining inside the pipe. Unfortunately, due to, a limited number of contractors, our consultants believe that the cost of it is more than double either of the other options, which was disappointing, I guess, from my perspective. It would have been nice to not do any digging on this. So that's the preferred option, is to replace the two 300 mil pipes with one 450 mil PVC pipe.
Questions for Councilor or Councilor Nixon?
So, just a question for staff, Your Worship. The money will be coming from the El Silhouette Crossing. To put that on hold anyway.
Yes.
That money is there. You've talked to the string list. So we're not borrowing from our reserves to do this.
No, Your Worship, the Il Silhouette Pipe Crossing, we did put in an application for the Strategic Priorities Fund grants for, through the federal gas tax grants. We haven't heard back from that, and with the federal election, we were hoping that we'd find out beforehand, but we still haven't found out on that project. We also did put a project application in for the intersection project that we've just approved moving forward with. So we're suggesting that we hold off. We have a design at about a 85-90% stage for the Illisawort water crossing. It's ready to go when we find out about funding. There's no real time constraints on that project. We're mostly outside of the riparian area with the methodology that we're considering. Mayor has talked to me about some other options, so this does give us an opportunity to review some of those other options as well on that project.
Thank you.
One of the questions I have is where this is going to go, I imagine, immediately. This project is going to start, it's already started.
Yeah, so what I'm suggesting is that the city would likely, and this is something that I'd want to talk about with the utilities crew, but the city would likely order the pipe materials immediately and then work out the procurement process from there. But I'd like to enter into an MMCD-style contract with the contractor to get this work done. So basically a unit price contract that is fair for both parties.
Would we be taking this opportunity to be putting a shutoff on here since we didn't have one on the other?
That's in the plan, yeah. Right. So, and we actually talked about that in a utilities meeting this morning, just on the ideal configuration of those valves. Definitely something that we try to do on all of our projects is improve the ability to shut water off to minimize the number of residents that have outages.
Okay, Councillor Lund.
Just one question, Your Worship. The two options, the open cut on the new alignment and the open cut on the existing alignment, are both $230,000+, but only separated by $5,000 in cost. Is one of them less riskier, and is that why you recommended the cheaper option?
So not recommending the cheaper option.
Yeah.
Part of my thinking of it is we've got an existing alignment that we know has they've blasted out rock for it, so there's less rock potentially to blast out. The additional cost is really just supplying water to the residents. It's a different way of continuing that supply in that time frame. But from my perspective, I think it actually has less risk to do it in the existing location.
Any more questions for Mr. Thomas? Motion is to approve the contract. Is at the $238,000 range. And all those in favor? Motion is carried. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Thomas. Financial focus.
Yes, Your Worship. I'll bring forward at the Finance Focus Group 2015 report we received and referred to budget discussion.
Moved by Councillor Nissen, seconded by Councillor English. Discussion? Councillor English.
Just wanted to say I had a quick look at, not a detailed look, but a quick look at the report, and I just want to thank the focus group, because I think you've done a really thorough and excellent job, and I know they put a lot of work in it. You could just tell by the amount of comments they made, so I just wanted to make sure we thank them.
Councillor Nixon.
Just as the finance chair, thank you. I think Mr. Weston's here at this meeting, and thank you from the finance committee for your work.
Councillor Mandel.
Again, I'd like to echo the appreciation. As most council members know, there's been lots of questions and emails and information provided, and they've really done a whole ton of work. So thanks to Nathan and Bob for taking part in this, and I'm looking forward to see what comes out of the discussions at the next stage from budget level.
Councilor English.
Again, would just like to publicly thank Mr. Weston and Mr. Melnick for the time and effort that they put into this. It really is a credit to them as citizens of this town to get involved and really try to help us make some decisions. Really, kudos, gentlemen. Thank you both very much.
I could have jumped in first and thanked, but I thought I'd let everybody else. But I too had my thanks. thanks to Bob, and it was one of my goals to, in the last election, was to bring back the financial focus group. We've done that, and I just want to let the public know that, that we have, I'm sure most people that are watching are realizing that we're way ahead of budget discussions than we were for the previous ones, and our goal is to sometime in January have a budget to present to the community and be ready for approval. And again, the financial focus group help us are helping us achieve those goals, and looking forward to the final result. Any other comments on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Parks and Rec.
Your Worship, item 9J, I move that report dated November 4th, 2015, prepared by the Director of Parks, Recreation, and Culture, be received for information, and that staff proceed with the scheduling of a public open house for Monday, November 23rd, 2015, from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. at the Community Center to review site plan options for Williamson's Lake Park and Campground.
Motion by Councilor Orlando, seconded by Councilor English. And Ms. Donato, you have a presentation for us?
Yes, Your Worship.
Beautiful. Thank you.
So this will be done in two parts. I'd like to just take an opportunity and just provide a little bit of background information on how we got to where we are today. And then I'm going to turn it over to Fraser Blythe of Selkirk Planning and Design, and he's going to speak to the concepts a bit more. So just to bring you up to speed, the discussion regarding future enhancements at Williamson's Lake Park and Campground actually started in 2011 when the previous staff initiated a site planning process. The intent of the process was to plan for future development and enhancements at the park. Having a well-defined site plan is the first step in moving forward with any future enhancements to the park. During this process, staff met with the Early Childhood Development Committee, the Rottingham Club, the Rotary Club, as well as the previous caretaker. These groups and individuals were referred to as stakeholders during that process. And the process consisted of reviewing the existing site plan, prioritizing existing upgrades to the existing buildings, and identifying new amenities. A briefing report was completed, however, a site plan was not developed at that time. So through last year's budget process, we allocated funds to complete the site plan and develop building concepts. So to get that process going, in July of this year, the briefing report was recirculated to the stakeholders involved in the initial process. They were asked to review the report and to confirm that their interest was addressed in the report. All stakeholders responded. Their responses were documented, and they all confirmed that their interests were represented in that report. From there, we developed three concept plans. Site plan, the first site plan focuses on enhancing the community aspect of the park. The second site plan focuses on further enhancing the campground component of the park. And the third site plan really tries to strike a balance between the campground and the community park aspect. The Parks and Rec Committee reviewed the concept plans at their meeting last week and recommended that staff move forward with the public consultation process. So we're recommending that the public consultation process take form of a open house format, and staff along with the consultants will be on hand to address any questions that come up. And I think I'll stop right there and introduce Fraser. He's going to touch a bit more on what happens following the consultation process, as well as give some background on the concepts. So I think most of you know Fraser Blythe with Selkirk Planning and Design. I will turn it over to him.
Okay, and this is just the minutes.
Yeah.